congregation. And listen, if he was here right now, he'd be outside. He wouldn't be in here listening. He'd be outside salting and helping people in the door. He'd have his umbrella out. He'd have all that stuff. And that's really what we're going to talk about. This is a celebration service. You know, listen, people call it memorial, people call it funeral, and it is a funeral, and we are going to remember Frank Carella, but we're more than that. We are going to celebrate who that man was, what he meant for all of us. Each one of us is here because we, and each one of us has a story, can tell stories about who this man is and what he did in our lives, how he spoke into our lives, how he prayed into our lives, how he led by example, and we want to honor him and celebrate him for all that work. We're going to start this morning. My name is Pastor Sean. I'm the pastor here at Cornerstone. Thank you for joining us today, and I appreciate just the immense amount of people that came out last night, and obviously still coming in the doors this morning. We appreciate you weathering the storm with us to celebrate with this family, to honor this man. We're going to open this morning with some hymns that the family said. These are Frank's favorite songs, and whatever Frank wants, we're going to do. And whatever, in this case, Carol wanted, we're going to do. We're going to sing these songs in just a moment. But I want to first start and open with a word of prayer, just getting our hearts and minds focused on what we're going to do this morning to remember Frank Carella. Let's pray this morning. God, I want to thank you for this opportunity, Lord. I want to thank you that we can celebrate. God, we're going to talk about why this is a celebration. And God, we do grieve. We are sad and our hearts are broken. But your word tells us that we have a hope within us. We do not grieve as this world grieves, because we have a hope. And it's more than just hoping that that Frank is with you in glory. It is knowing that he lives. We celebrate that this morning. And we pray that everything we do, everything that we say, everything we do in remembrance of Frank and celebrate his life, all is done to bring honor and to bring glory to you, because that is what he desires. In the name of Jesus, be spoken today. In the name of Jesus, to be glorified today. So I invite you to sing these songs with us this morning. You don't have to stand. If you want to stand, that's fine. But we're going to sing these songs of worship. These are hymns, but these are worship songs. Let's worship him this morning.
And on a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. I love that old cross where the dearest and best for the world of lost sinners was slain. So I cherish the old rugged cross until my trophies at last I down. And I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to the dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. And I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
every time that we would sing a hymn here at Cornerstone, every single time, Frank would come to me after service and he would say, "Thank you for singing that hymn today. You know I love those songs that you sing. I love those modern songs of worship. But I love those old hymns." And that's why we're honoring him with those hymns this morning. This one is, if you want to talk about a song, and I don't know if he would ever consider it, I would, just knowing the man, I would consider this a song that he would sing and say to people every single day, simply turn your eyes upon Jesus. No matter what situation, circumstance that Frank found you in, if you were a family member going through something, if you were a stranger that he met in a job somewhere, he would say, turn your eyes upon Jesus, and sing that this morning.
And turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful faith, and the things of earth will grow strange in the light of his glory and grace. So turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory.
Say a few words. You know, this is a tremendous opportunity for the family to just, and listen, we were talking last night, it's hard to put, I know, it's hard to put in some simple words what your father, what your brother, your husband, whatever my case may be, means to you. But I can tell you that whatever this family says is from the heart. And I can tell you, just being with this family this week and talking to them, Dad is so proud of them, so incredibly proud of them. I have to tell you something. I was going to tell you the message, but I'm going to share it now because I feel led to. Sunday night, we were meeting with them, and at the end of our talking about what we wanted to do, I said, is there anything else that you would want part of this message? All three of his kids, all sitting in front of me, said, Dad would want to have an altar call. Dad would want to have a message of hope. He wanted us to talk about Jesus and how to find Jesus. And I told Ross this week, I said, that might right. When you, as soon as you all said that, your dad is just so super proud. He went, yes, they got it. That's exactly what I want to hear. So I'm honored to be part of this service today. And I thank you all for being here. We want to invite whatever part of the family are going to come up now and speak some words to us and encourage us, maybe make us laugh, obviously make us cry. That's all part of the celebration this morning.
Sharing the love that you have with him. Celebration, his accomplishments in life, his family, fighting fiercely in Vietnam as a tank commander when half the population was running to Canada with their draft cards burning. The creation of an electric chair in our basement where they tortured my sister. I can't think of many more. I'm drawing a blank here, but you guys have all warmed my heart, and my brother is grateful for having you in his life, and the world has changed. Yesterday, I woke up crying, thinking, world has changed because my brother's not the head of the family anymore. It's like the world's here. Frank was there. But it has changed for the better because Frank brought good things to this world. And he was always the head of the family, the leader. He always encouraged us to be better. He always reminded us to be better. We always strived to be like him, but couldn't quite make it. He always reminded me to be a good man, to believe in God. And before I left California, he reminded me that 205 pounds does not fit into a 180-pound suit. Thank you, brother. Anyway, thank you all for coming. I love you very much, and I'm grateful to have you in my life, as my brother was. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Nathan. I'm the youngest of the boys. I love this picture. That's me at 11. That's Tom at 16. Frank's about 25, 26 right there. And he brought me out a new 20-gauge shotgun. I'm the hunter killer in the family. I don't know if you know this about me, but yeah. My brother, you know, I didn't expect to come out and see my brother like this. The next trip was supposed to be him coming out and help me excavate for power for a new house we're trying to build in North Idaho. Our mother dragged us by the ear to church. Tom, you remember this. She would hunt us down in the neighborhood and scream our name to make sure that she grabbed us and dragged us into these Pentecostal churches. Bless her heart. And I mean, it was short of snake charming. If you've seen these snake charming type Pentecostal people, you know, those kinds of holy roller churches. And though I didn't and still don't partake in that type of worship, what stuck with all of us was Mom's belief in Jesus Christ and her faith. And it affected every one of us. And to this day, this is why Frank was such a strong Christian and is such a strong Christian. I say he is because I don't feel like my brother's gone. I have no problem in saying that my brother's still here. It lives in every one of you and in me. My brother, growing up without a dad, because my parents had split up, we moved to California. It was unfortunate. It was the way it is. Parents do those kinds of things and don't realize how it affects their children. My brother was like a father to me and still is. He was just such a strong spiritual guide to me. We talk a lot for being so distant. And we had such a great conversation on the 26th. The last Wednesday was our mom's birthday, my brother Ronnie's birthday also, who's not here today. And I wanted to know more about my father. And I know and I'd heard he spoke to each member of our family in the last week. He had a great celebration with Nikki and his birthday Friday night. They went out to dinner and had a great time. It was really unusual things happening. The Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit working through these circumstances over the last week as my brother got things in order and didn't realize that his time was to be what it was last Friday. None of us know our time. And I do want to share with you today something that my brother would share. And, you know, we had a great conversation about not only my father, but Carol in the background. You were so funny in the background. He was really relaxed. He was really calm. He's, you know, I'm like, my dad's not like me. That's got to be from our mom, you know, this excited fly off the handle stuff. Yeah, okay, whatever. Frank had a very calming spirit. You know this. We had a great conversation, and I happen to be in a book called The Man God Uses, and this is something I've been reading every morning, and it's 14 characteristics of a godly man. You know, the Bible's really simple. Jesus said, come to me like a little child, right? To be saved, you just have to believe. You have to believe in a man that walked across water. I've never seen anybody do it. I tried in a swimming pool a couple of times, you know, just pretending, what's this like? You know, it's crazy and it's blind faith. And Jesus said to his disciples, you guys are all blessed because you got to hang out with me. You witnessed these miracles, right? Doubly blessed. Blessed are those ahead, us, that have to believe in blind faith, right? And a Jesus, in a Messiah that was nailed to a cross, that took all of our sin, nailed it, left it, resurrected, moved on to the right hand of his Father. This is our Savior. This free insurance policy has been paid for everybody in here. If you don't believe in Jesus, you should. Can you imagine somebody coming to your door and saying, this fantastic life insurance policy is all taken care of for you, and it's been paid for. You don't have to do a thing. There are no payments. There's nothing you can do, right? It's already been done. Why would you not want this free gift? If Jesus doesn't exist, if this was all a lie, I'm a better man than I would have been had I not known Jesus, right? I know who I am and where I was in my life, where Frank was in his life, where Tom was in his life. We all know this about each other, our dirty little secret of sin. I know I won't say nothing. Yeah. Anyway, we know where we are today, and it was because of our salvation. There is a change in a man's life. And let me tell you, if it is true, I have eternal life. I go off to a great spot where my brother is right now with my mother. We all go off to this great spot. If you don't believe, Jesus said there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is not a pleasant place, evidently. I don't want to go there. Jesus is real. You all have the ability, out of free will that we've been given by God, to accept or reject this free offer. If you don't know Jesus Christ, I will do that altar call right now. It's as simple as saying, you know, I choose to believe. And once you believe, that belief can't be taken from you, no matter what you do. It's already been paid for. It's already been done. I want to sit here. I want to talk more about my brother, but I know this is the most important thing that my brother would have expressed to you. Okay? Because we feel the same way. This book is 14 characteristics of a godly man. I'm on chapter 8. My brother exhibits every bit of this book. Nobody had to train him. You know, he understood that if you read the word, if you pray, if you love your family, you know, God is love. You're doing these things. You will exhibit these things. My brother is the best example of a godly man that shared with everybody that he could through God's love. If God is love, every time we love someone, we're experiencing God. I urge you today, if you don't know Christ, I don't know what else to say. I miss my brother. I didn't expect this trip to be anything other than a visit to my brother the next time we went to to New York from where we're from. Sorry, California, earlier last year. I fully expected to hang out with him. My brother not only liked to shoot, he loved to ride. He used to put me on his Honda Dream in the mid-60s, and we used to cruise along the Hudson River, and I'd sit on this black gas tank with the chrome panels. I love that, you know, no helmet, 5 years old. Kid, you know there's not a seatbelt on a bike. Yeah, my first introduction to motorcycles, I never lost that love for motorcycles. I never, I've had bikes all my life. My brother Tom got the keys to mine as we left California and said, here, brother, enjoy the ride. Look at him, he's smiling over there, enjoying the ride. Yeah. Oh, it's a great bike. But the many things that I did in life were because of my brother. I watched our mother during Vietnam War send gifts and, you know, cookies, cameras and stuff to Frank, to Ronnie, to Mike, and never know if they got to Vietnam, and they didn't. A lot of that stuff didn't make it. And I remember the conversation, the letters coming back with that red and white striped border around them. These were airmail back in the day. You guys, everyone's got phones these days. You can communicate so easy. No, moms worry about their boys off fighting and dying for these useless wars that politicians are unwilling to take up an M4 and get over and do themselves. So, though I'm a gun guy, I'm completely against, you know, the war machine, let's just say. Because young men like that, heart that you see here. He's a hero to me. Like Tom said, when men were running north to Canada to hide, not my family. Today we wouldn't have it either. I would gladly fight. My brothers would gladly fight, even if it's for something that seems useless, because it's our honor, it's our duty, and it's our godly right. I don't want to keep going on. My brother's a hero. My brother's picked the most fun. God, I like making you mad so I can hear your Scottish accent. Beautiful Scottish woman, and have all these beautiful children. I love you all. My brother loved you and did a great job with Carol of raising you to have all these grandkids and this whole room. Last night, you guys saw the testimony to Frank. We couldn't find parking out there. You know, that's a testimony to a godly man who's loved in his community, who gave himself for it. So, I love you all. I'm so grateful to be here. I feel the spirit of my brother here. I've shed tears like Tom off and on. I don't feel any tears today. I feel happiness and joy for my brother and where he is. He's with my mom and with all of her relatives that believe. And it happens like that. We don't know when.
Family. Ronnie couldn't be here because he got exposed to COVID. My sister couldn't be here because she got exposed to COVID. And I just want you all to know how much she loved Frank and Ron loves Frank. And they couldn't be here. It breaks their heart. But I had to mention how much they cared for Frankie, and they couldn't be here. That's all. I won't mention the torturing anymore.
Do you know me? Who, those of you who don't, sorry. My name's Ross McNeil. Don't be confused by my name. I'm a proud son. Most people don't get to choose their families, but luckily for me and my mom, my dad chose us. I'll thank God for the rest of my life. And when I stand before his throne, I'll thank him again. Privilege and the honor of being my dad's son. I didn't think I'd make it this far. So I picked a song to do my talking for me. It's a song that I played for my dad when our son Connor was born, his first grandson, and I'd like to play it for again now. Mm-hmm.
because he didn't have to be. You know he didn't have to be. Thank you.
at work, and I said, I was exhausted to tell a story. I said, there were words, and then there were feelings, and I don't know after that. So, that's about how I cover it. My songs, my dad let me listen to music. He was pretty free with that, but I don't have any songs like Ross shared today. So I'm just going to share my first letter to Dad since last Friday. I've been talking to Dad, praying with Dad, and praying for Dad all week. I'm looking forward to doing that after this chaos ends. But for now, this is what I could drum together at his desk where he has his first devotion of the day. I count devotions, monthly devotions, and Dad has like daily four or five. So the first one was at his desk alone. So I sat there and cried a little and thought of Dad. So here's my letter to Dad. Hey Dad, I'm missing you, Dad. I'm feeling a little numb and cheated a lot. Dad was really good at letting you come in hot like that, with your heart and looking at you with his eyes without saying anything, and his eyes would just say, just lay it on me, I got you. There's so much more I need to learn from you and about you. I'll be watching and listening for you everywhere, Dad. I'm so blessed to have the things you prepared me with, including learning how to shave, and learning how to stop the bleeding with toilet paper. He was always prepared, from a snack stash in his truck to the random tool you needed that's labeled and in its place in his garage, to the right Bible passage or story to share when you needed comfort. Some of the things he prepared me with, starting with the variety of trades you passed down, which helped me build a home for my family, just like you did, Dad. The practice of perseverance, which has helped me navigate many battles and adversity in an imperfect past through an indifferent world. The joy and generosity, the meaning of mercy, the goodness of gratitude, keeping commitments, and being tender while being strong, and being accountable when we're wrong. Most importantly, Dad, you taught me that God is the cheat code to purpose and peace through this uncertain life and the path to paradise. I'm grateful for a lifetime of existing with you. Thank you for everything, Dad. Your trip was too short, Dad. Shine your love light in paradise. Talk soon. Rest easy, Dad.
Watching the service. So she said, my brother Frankie, you will be missed but not forgotten. You are truly one of the most gentle, kindest, warmest, and loving persons on this earth. You are a wonderful husband to Carol. I love that you loved her, and your love was like no other. It could never be matched, and it will live on forever. Your children, the way you molded them and raised them, and what they've become will carry on with their children. Your grandchildren, so honored that you have. your grandchildren so honored to have you as a grandfather and to have felt the love that you had for them. You were what a grandfather is about. Your hugs so warm and caring. You were the most wonderful and loving brother anyone could want and have. And I am so grateful that I've had you as mine. Your smile and laugh was like no other. So funny, it was one of a kind. I know when you left this earth that Mom was there waiting for you with open arms and a smile that lit up heaven. I can just imagine her saying, "Oh, Frankie, my Frankie." And having your favorite chicken and dumplings ready, waiting for you, just like she would when you and Carol would come down and visit. Please give Mom a hug for me and tell her that I love her and miss her. With love, your little sister. Let them know I'm your baby sister. And if it's okay to say this, if it's not too late, that was honey.
Thank you. Of course, that's what this is all about. This is the celebration, so I appreciate that. You know, the ability for the family to share this. Listen, you guys already preached my message. We're all done. You guys did everything I wanted to do. No, we wanted to do a couple more things. This song, I kind of just want to do as a special for you this morning. My dad, many of you know my dad just passed away a few weeks ago. And so this is a song that we sang at his service. And when I was met with the family, they said, well, Frank would like that song as well. So we're going to sing the song this morning. It's an adaptation of that great old hymn, "It Is Well With My Soul." Because it really is well with our souls. I know we're sad, I know we're grieving. But when our faith and trust is where it should be, we could still be well.
That's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. It is well, it is well. So let go my soul and trust in Him. The waves and wind still know His name. Let go my soul and trust in Him. The waves and wind still know His name. The waves and wind still know His name. It is well with my soul. It is well. Well, with my soul. well. Oh, it is well with my soul. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me.
Again, I want to thank the family for your words this morning. When I sat down to kind of write a few words as a celebration message to share with you, obviously what Frank not only meant to all of us, but what he really meant for the kingdom of God. One of the things that was, Nikki, I think I had talked about, or you mentioned your heels, those 4 inches, I mean, that made you appear a little taller than your dad. You know, I think it was Peter that said it right. I never realized, you know, actually how small the man was, because like you, and I've known him for many, many years, I never realized I looked down when I talked to him, because through the course of his life and the things and my interactions with him, maybe physically his stature was shorter than I am, but I always looked up to him, and I think you know what I'm talking about. He walked with a presence. And not an arrogant presence. There's nothing arrogant about the man, but he walked with the presence because he has a peace with his God. He walked with the purpose in his life because God had given him that purpose. And so we are going to celebrate who he is this morning. We're here to celebrate the life and the legacy of Frank Carella. It's hard to use the word celebration at times like this. I know for some of you it might be kind of foreign to you. Hey, listen, what do you mean by celebrating? This is a memorial. This is a funeral. We don't mourn like the world mourns. We don't. We're sad, we grieve, we go through the same emotions, trust me, I know. But we have a blessed assurance, this amazing grace, this hope that supersedes everything else. We use this word celebrate because Frank's life deserves the use of that word. We mourn his earthly passing, but we celebrate who he was as a person. We also use that word celebrate because we know that is what we're going to do one day again when we see him. We also use that word celebrate because that's what he's doing right now. Something that I was even talking this morning with my mom about my dad and Frank together. My mom said, you know what? Who'd imagine my dad is up in glory, and just a few short weeks later, Frank shows up. Hey, Pastor Mike, I'm here. It's true. It's true. And as much as we are grieving in our hearts and saddened, there's not a single tear in heaven right now. Celebration for this man's life. Anyone who met Frank, and you obviously have met Frank, but anybody who met Frank, interacted with Frank, you were automatically met with a smile, and not a fake smile. He was one of our, he did many things here as a trustee and as a faithful member of this church for many, many years. Frank was also our parking lot dude. He was the one that took care of our parking lot, and Karen and I were talking last night. You know, we had an immense amount of turnout in our parking lot last night. We had people parked up and down Shutt Road. I was really seriously waiting for the town of Walk Hill to show up, red and blue lights, and saying, what's going on? They did not. And Bill Whitaker, who was outside, said, if they show up, I'm just going to say Frank Carella. And they'd be like, okay, that's fine. Right? Because there was it. But when he showed up in a parking lot, one of the reasons he was so good at greeting people, because he was genuine. When he saw someone come for the first time or for the 100th time, he was excited to see them come to church. He would go out of his way. I love when we had first-time visitors would come here. Frank would greet them in the parking lot. And if it was raining, he would have an umbrella up there. If it wasn't raining, he would just escort them into the building and bring them, by the time, whether it was my dad as Pastor Mike or now in my case, he would bring them to me and say, hey, Sean, this is Johnny. He's the first time he's been here today. He's already knew all the thing about Johnny. They're already best friends. They're friends on Facebook. They go out to lunch or whatever, right? And this, I just want to introduce you to my pastor, right? And he didn't do that. But seriously, he would connect with people so quickly. I shared with the family this last week. and I found out that kids didn't even know this. So I'm going to tell Frank Carella a secret for all of you Cornerstone people and people have met him here. You ever wonder why just Frank always remembered your names? And maybe you visited and you came back a second time and he knew who you were as soon as you came out of the car. This is his secret. The man kept a notebook in his front pocket. True story. When someone come in and they were a visitor, he would write down the type and make and model of the car, right, like he was a cop, write down the make and model of the car. And then as he introduced himself to you, he'd write down their names. If they were kids, he'd write down the kids' names and their ages and all this stuff. And he did that. So the next time they came, he'd see a white Corolla come in, and he'd be like, oh, that's Johnny, his wife Susie, and they have three kids. And so when Johnny and Susie stepped out of the car, he would greet them by name. You can't teach that stuff when it comes to first impressions. The impact that he had, his friendly demeanor, his genuine smile and kindness. When I think of Frank, I also immediately think of all the things that he did for me. Last night we were sharing stories of all the things that he did for others. Going out of his way to help. Going out of his way to see a need. And it wasn't just like, hey, you go to Frank and say, I have a need. He would absolutely help you out, whatever the case is. But he didn't wait for people to come and tell him they had a need. He looked for the need. He looked for those who needed a shoulder to cry on. He looked for those who needed a hand shoveling their driveway. He looked for those in need. There's a lesson to be learned in that this morning. He was always looking to step in. There was no hesitation in him whatsoever. Frank was a husband, a father, a pop. And evident through all those roles he took, first and foremost, he was a faithful servant to his Lord and Savior. And the reason that he was so good at those other things is because he put God first in his life in every area of his life, whether it was parking cars and guiding people in a parking lot, walking them to the door, whether it was showing up to bring you groceries or take you out to eat, right, or shoveling your walkway, whether it was just praying with you. He displayed the kindness and gentleness and faithfulness of a servant of God because that's who he was. His love displayed his devotion. John chapter 13, verses 35 says this. This is so important to understand. By this, all people will know, this is Jesus speaking, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. If you met you for 100th time or for the first time, he loved people. Frank shared Jesus with everyone. He shared him through his words, absolutely. But even more evident, more important in many cases was through his actions. See, it's easy to in our words, to say something. It's a much different thing to actually have action and compassion behind that. He shared Jesus through his words and also through his actions. See, words are cheap if they're not followed up by actions. Frank's words never lacked action. He never said something that he wasn't going to do. There's a serious, just a few weeks ago, Frank has been a longtime trustee and a leader here at Cornerstone. For many, many years, faithfully, every 3 years, we'd have to vote in a new trustee, and his term actually was just coming up this year. And I knew it, and I went to look at who was coming up, and I saw Frank's name was coming up, and I said, oh, man, I was hoping he had a couple more years left. And I knew he had been a trustee for a long time. And listen, he had done his duty, so to speak. He really had. In the situation I find myself in with my dad, who was a longtime pastor here, and just in the time of life that I am in, I had, and Frank has been very involved in calling me and checking in on me and praying with me. I just talked to Frank last week. I took him aside the Sunday before church business meeting. Poor girl's trying to leave. Frank, listen, he would always say he was waiting on his bride. He never waited on his bride. His bride was always waiting on him, right? Because he was always involved in talking and helping. What do you need? And I pulled him aside. I said, Carl, I'm sorry. Can I borrow for 1 minute? And we went to the office. And I said, Frank, we have the business meeting next week. We have to vote on a new tenure for a trustee. And he stopped me. He says, I already know what you're going to ask. My answer is yes. If you need me, I'm yours. I'll help you. I'll do whatever you need me to do. And was so humbled by that. And so then we had a meeting. I took the opportunity to let people know that how faithful as a servant he was and continued to be. Because his words didn't just stop at words, they were action.
He saw a need. He advanced on that need. And here's the thing, we were talking about this last night. Someone mentioned to me, I forget who it was. But when he looked for needs and when he actually helped people, he never once expected anything in return for that. Never once. God forbid you try to pay the man money for anything. I mean, just not too long ago, he came to our house in emergency. This is I've told the story many times already this past few days. I'll tell it again because it's a funny one. My wife had mentioned to him, this is about a year and a half ago, I imagine, right? We were still living in, we had a townhouse over here. And she had mentioned on a Sunday morning that she smelled gas coming from our laundry room. She goes, I think it's gas. It's very faint. We have to get it checked out. I didn't know about this. He called me after church and said, hey, just letting you know, yeah, I heard, overheard, or Tyler told me that I don't feel comfortable. I can't even go home right now until I know you guys are safe. So he came over to my house. He picked up some supplies, came over to my house, and he says, I can't jump behind your dryer. You're going to have to do that. But if you go behind there, I'll tell you how to fix it. And we fixed my dryer. And of course, I mean, because he picked up supplies, he had spent his time with us, and I said, you're not going to take it, but can I please pay you? He was offended. I'm not going to take anything. You do enough. This is anything I can do for you. He never once expected anything in return. There's lots to learn in that as well. Today we honor how he lived, and I want to point you towards a hope. And we talked about the hope. I want to point you towards that hope that can see you through your grief. It's the same faith, the same hope that Frank had, and it's the same faith that still continually binds this family together. The book of Hebrews chapter 6, verses 17 and 18 says this. It says, God also bound himself with an oath. When God binds himself to an oath, you better believe that that oath is true. It says this, so that those who receive the promise could be perfectly sure that he would never change his mind. So God has given both his promise and his oath. Two things, right? These two things are unchangeable because it is impossible for God to lie. Therefore, we who have fled to him for refuge can have great confidence as we hold to the hope that lies before us. This is why we're sad. This is why we use the word grieve. But this is why this is also a celebration. God has promised. He bound himself to an oath to us. Those who flee to him for refuge, whatever your situation may be, whatever your sadness may be, whatever your story is, whatever you're going through in your life, in other words, those who seek refuge in God will find that hope. It doesn't matter the situation. Whether it's grieving the loss of a loved one, whether it's grieving a loss of a job, whether it's grieving a relationship in your life, whatever it may be, whatever refuge you need, God has bound himself with an oath, and we can hold to the hope that lies before us. Hope is the reason I can stand here today. Hope is what binds us together. I can't answer why things happen. I wish I knew the answer to that. I wish I knew the answer to the timing of God in my own life. My dad had this saying, and I'm paraphrasing it. He wrote it in everything in his Bible, every one of his Bibles, save for God, wrote this. He says, I will not enter my prayer chamber and question the dealings of my God. In other words, God knows a lot more than I do. And when I go to God, I'm not going to go to him saying, well, I can't believe you did this. I'm going to go to God, in other words, saying, you did this in my life. This happened in my life, but I know you have a reason. I know you have a purpose for it. So I can't answer the why, but I can point you towards God's promise and his oath towards us, and we can find refuge in him. We can have confidence in whatever life throws at us when our hope lies in God and not on ourselves. This is the hope that we cling to today. This is the hope that you too can experience in your life. We're facing there's a physical storm happening, and it doesn't look too bad right now. I actually don't see anything falling. But, you know, living in the Northeast, wherever you live, there's storms. There's things in our environments, things that we face. And there's also storms, obviously, that we face in our lives. We are going through a storm right now. This family is going through a storm right now. My family is going through a storm right now as well. Storms are scary. There's uncertainty. There's prediction. People try to guess the best outcome, but there's still some nervousness, some anxiety that always comes along with storms. In the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, verses 35 and 41, it talks about a storm, a physical storm that happened with the disciples with Jesus in the Sea of Galilee. I'm not going to read the whole story, but most of you probably understand what happened here. They're out in the Sea of Galilee, and the storm had risen up, and it was shaking this boat left and right. It was all over the place. And these disciples, Jesus' disciples, they had just left the day of teaching with Jesus, and they're out in the middle of the Sea of Galilee, and it's scary out there. Do you remember where Jesus was during the storm? He was down in the boat sleeping, right? And it was during that storm the disciples were starting to give up hope. They were scared. But in the middle of that storm, Jesus calmed against the raging sea. So the long and short of it is Jesus woke up. They woke Jesus up. He walked out. And I like to imagine he walked out into the deck of that boat, and he sees them all freaking out and yelling and crying and upset. And I imagine this, that Jesus almost turned to them and said, "Are you serious? We've been through this many, many times." Jesus called upon that storm to cease, and it ceased immediately. I bring that up to you today to remind you that there's no guarantee about facing storms in your life. I wish that when you became a believer in Christ, I wish that part of that provision is that we don't have to face heartache and grief. That's not, unfortunately, that's not the way that God has designed this world and not designed us to be in this world. We are going to experience these things in our life. And it might be this storm, and a few years from now it might be other storms. Next week it might be something completely different. And some of you have experienced storms and trials and turmoil, things in your life that others cannot even understand. But I'm here to remind you, there's no guarantee against facing storms in your life. But when we have hope in Jesus, we also have hope that he will never leave nor forsake us. It's his oath to us. It's easy during the storm to think that God has forgotten you or that he doesn't care, because that's what happens. It's the first thing that happens in our lives when a storm occurs. A lot of us, the first thing we think of is, God, why are you allowing this to happen? God, why am I going through this? We need to remember this. It's easy during the storm to think that God has forgotten you or that he doesn't care. The truth is, however, he cares more about you than you could ever imagine. In the middle of the Sea of Galilee, Jesus, who was sleeping, woke up and heard their cries. Today, he hears our cries. And today he can calm the storms in your life, no matter what those storms are. You're saying to yourself, well, I have these storms. I know what you're talking about. There's no way God can help me in this. I've faced them for a long time. There's no hope for the situation I'm living in. Romans 5:8 says this, but God demonstrated his own love towards us, and that way, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. To have hope like this family does, you need to know the God that provides that hope. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's hope. It's hope in the middle of everything. We can celebrate today because of that hope. Though we experience sadness at his leaving this earth, as believers in God, we know that this is not the end. It is not the end. Beginning of something very beautiful for Frank. Beginning of eternity. And if you have that same hope, that same faith, you too can experience what it is to have peace that surpasses understanding. I say this often here at Cornerstone, and I say it to remind myself. This is why I say it so often. The Bible tells us that God's plans for us are beyond our ability to understand, which means this. If God will actually set you down one-to-one, and so you know what? You always worry about what's happening in your life, so I'm going to just tell you step-by-step what's going to happen in your life. If God sat down with you and said, this is my plan for you. For the next 2 years, this is what's going to happen. Then after that, you're going to go into this relationship and whatever. If he laid out every single moment of your life and told you this is what's going to happen, it's beyond your ability to understand. You won't be able to comprehend it. It wouldn't make sense to you. But here's the thing with hope. You don't have to make sense to have hope. It's the thing with faith. You just have to trust and have faith and have hope. What made Frank who he was? What made him a great father? A great husband, a great pop to his grandkids, a faithful servant within this church, and a faithful witness for Christ throughout this whole entire world and across this world. Yes, he was an awesome guy. Yes, he was a caring father. But he put his faith and hope and trust in Jesus, and everything else fell into place. When you put God first in your life, God's going to take care of your life. When you put God first in your life, those storms that you face in your life, God is going to, with his oath, is going to see you through those storms. He's going to give refuge to those who seek refuge. I do invite you to just bow your heads this morning. And to honor this man, I wanted to share something I know he wants me to share. For all of you here in person, for those of you watching us online, I want to share with you who our Jesus is. Our Jesus was sent to this world as a sinless Son of God who lived a perfect life upon this world, fulfilled a ministry, a calling, a duty in his life. Then he was arrested, beaten, put upon a cross, killed, murdered, because that is the only thing that could pay, redeem us from our sins. The blood of Jesus. Then 3 days after he was crucified, killed upon that cross, he rose from that grave. There's that hope. There's that faith. There's that trust. The Bible tells us if you simply call upon the name of the Lord, believe in your heart, believe in your mind that he is Lord, ask him to forgive you of your sins, you too will experience that joy. Psalm 16:11, you will show me the path of life, and your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. That is what Frank has and had in his life. That is what you can have as well if you put your faith and trust in him. And if you would simply, even as you're sitting there watching us this morning, simply call out to him and say, Jesus, I am a sinner in need of salvation. God, I've tried living my life on my own. I've tried all these things to try to bring happiness and joy and contentment to my life, but I always come up short. And when storms hit my life just falls apart. I call upon the name of Jesus to forgive me of my sins, to be the king of my heart, the king of my life, to be my redeemer, to be my savior. I ask forgiveness of my sins. So God, forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. You pray that prayer this morning, and you mean it with your heart, then you too can experience hope and joy and peace through that amazing grace of Christ's Savior. God, I pray for everyone here this morning, this family that grieves, this church family that grieves, family and friends across this world. They're here to celebrate the life of Frank. God, we thank you for giving him to us and blessing our lives with his life. And God, my challenge for all of us this morning is he's left a hole that we need to pick up those pieces, carry on that faithful, loving, and serving. That each one of us will start thinking about things in our life that we can do to show love to our fellow man. But even more importantly, to share Jesus with our fellow man. So God, thank you for the life of Frank. Thank you for his family. Thank you for this time that we have this morning. In your precious and holy name, amen. If you would stand with me this morning, I want to sing one last song with you as we are leaving. And that is Amazing Grace. Did you have something?
Carella, sister-in-law faster than me. He was determined to be the spiritual leader in our home. As a result, we have a family we love with all our hearts and are so proud. Frank was a true servant for his God, his family, his church, and his friends. There was no one unrecognizable to me last night. If I had not met you in person, I had met you in prayer. You can be assured, if you had shared a trouble, a sorrow, or a joy with Frank, you were prayed for by us. If it wasn't confidence, it was just between him and God. We, our family, will need your prayers and support for strength. And I ask that you pray for Connor, Mallory, Cameron, Bailey, Callan, and Kai, who will have to grow up without their pa. I'd like to read a scripture that's just on my heart right now, Romans 8:38 and 39. You know what, please say it with me. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. And nothing can separate us from the love we have for Frank. We know where he is. And like this scripture promises, not even death can separate us from God's love, Frank's love. He's in our hearts. Thank you.
Stand up this morning as we are finishing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Let's sing this together.
And amazing grace, and how sweet the sound that saves a wretch like me. And I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. Oh, how precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, with no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
Thank you this morning. We are going to have a luncheon for everybody. We're going to ask if you want to enjoy some coffee, we have some coffee set back in the cafe. If you want to grab some coffee, if you don't have coffee, you don't mind just switching to the right side to your left, I guess. We're over this side of the auditorium. We're going to just quickly roll out tables, get that transition over as quickly as possible. But thank you all for being here, and you're all invited to stay and join us for lunch as well. Thank you so much.